What I think is the AI science challenge, which is basically how do we solve really, really hard problems that, given all experts by themselves and all massive computer structures, parallel, whatever, cannot solve by themselves. So is there a way we can create a structure that can actually be able to solve those kinds of problems? And so the answer that sort of at the top level could in some sense be that I'm trying to really get at this symbiotic human-computer architecture that's going to try to leverage the best of both worlds towards really solving something that everything in isolation cannot solve. And so in the process of thinking of it this way, I came up with sort of the only sort of way that I could reason about getting at that particular architecture from knowing very little at the outset. And that is to actually start a co-adaptation where we evolve both people and interactions or software tools. So basically what we want is people at scale, not just the scientists currently, but all sorts of people from all walks of life should be becoming experts in perhaps a narrow but highly useful domain towards that particular problem. And in addition, all of our software tools, interactions, algorithms really need to sort of over time optimally adapt themselves towards the best performance, right? So only through this co-adaptation we can basically do this. And I started actually embedded these things in games not because I thought games would be an easy thing to do, it's extremely hard, but because it's a very nice mechanism in which you can actually start co-adapting these two things. So let me just give you a sense of sort of why there is actually reason to think about that this is exciting and promising, and then I will go in slightly deeper into the set of aspects that I have discovered in this process. So we've started looking at the problem of predicting protein structures. So you know, each one of these letters here is an amino acid, and really the holy grail is predicting the structure of these proteins. Anybody? Because everything about this structure controls what happens in a cell. So if you know, if you can predict the structure of proteins, you know the secret to life in some sense. Unfortunately, we don't. And we don't, despite huge number of scientists working on this kind of problem, and despite massive computational efforts to do the same thing. So, how many of you have heard of Foldit, the game? All right, so we'll go very quickly through this anyway. So, by the way, this didn't just come overnight. This is basically, we had 2 years of fast iterative evolution over all aspects of this game towards optimal outcomes. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that. But you know, what you're saying is sort of the end result. Just some insight into this. Here we're actually looking at the complete novices coming in, and we're looking at how long they're persisting towards more increasing challenges that eventually lead them towards open challenges. So, for example, what we're seeing here, and the dates are here at the bottom. So this is now almost 8 years ago, right? So we were doing this manually. We were looking at the big gaps, which is where we lose most number of people, because this is attrition. We change it. We look at this a few days later. It's a complex system. It introduces new set of gaps, and we basically optimize the entire process for several years, as I mentioned. So the outcomes are actually pretty interesting. If you look at sort of what people are able to do versus what massive computational efforts are able to do, the computers are able to sample 10 to 100 times more samples than people, okay? But if you notice here, all of those samples lie in these yellow dots, okay? Whereas 100 times fewer samples are the green dots, which is what people are doing. So even with much smaller sampling, they're actually they're sort of span much wider set of space. But perhaps even more interestingly is to observe the actual trajectory of people through this space. So obviously we want to get here, this is sort of the best energy-wise and the best closeness to the known native structure. So you can basically see a person goes off into Neptune, like terrible space, right? No algorithm would ever sort of persist on some really bad structure for a while before they find an ultimate route towards
it's that kind of hypothesis holding and experimenting on sort of different scales that is key thing that people are contributing to this process that almost no computational efforts can even start to do right now, perhaps sometime in the future. Okay, so that's just one insight. There are of course many. People have, with basically only one chemistry class or less experience in this space, have published, we just published actually a fourth Nature paper I didn't include it here. This one, for example, was a problem that scientists were trying to predict this structure for 14 years. They at some point say, oh, we heard about folding, why don't we send the structure to them? 10 days later, the structure, new structure was proposed, 2 weeks later confirmed in lab. So we had like 14 years, 10 days. It was kind of really exciting, of course. The press caught wind of this, et cetera. But this is sort of the key thing to me that it basically shifted my entire research direction because I realized, okay, we created a completely new pathway towards this expertise development, and there's a lot more stuff we can do here. So since then, we've been focusing on creativity. So now, instead of just predicting the proteins, we're actually designing drugs that interact in the right way with respect to the protein itself. Or perhaps, designing sort of completely new protein structures that nature hasn't figured out yet. So basically, completely new designs, including sort of protein machines. Now, I also tell you something that we just started with last year, and I think it's going to have even bigger impact on Folded. So together with Allen Institute for Brain Science, also in Seattle, we started looking at the entire neuroscience pipeline. What I realized is that there's throughout the whole pipeline, there's a huge amount of stuff. They're basically bottlenecked at every place because they have more data than they're able to actually analyze, process, and reason about, and model. And so the goal became sort of, can we produce high-quality reconstructions of these neurons at scale by developing novices such that we can actually be 100 times faster than what the science is doing now? So the first thing I'll tell you is that they had, I think, 15 people at the center doing this kind of reconstruction. And within 3 months of this project, they replaced their existing tools with the tools that were not designed for them. They were designed for novices. But they themselves were 10 times faster with these new structures. Now we actually announced the game. It's actually been published in Neuron Journal. So people are actually now starting to join. What's exciting here, I'll show you, is that there are a whole bunch of algorithmic structures underneath what is actually going on, from consensus determination. Here, actually, this is a playback of a sort of sped up, obviously, of reconstruction of what the people are actually doing. This goes on for a while. But what's interesting is that once this reconstruction happens, there's a separate problem, which is classification. Now, so all these neurons have different shapes. How can we actually organize them in an ontology that actually makes sense and will help the science go forward? That is a relatively unknown thing, and people will be taking part in that process. Then there's sort of temporal information of signal sending. Again, how do we build models of these neurons that are actually accurate to what is directly observed to happen in living brains? And even sort of modeling connectomes. And the thing that's most relevant perhaps to this audience is that this is what's underneath the entire structure, right? So you start with some automated methods. So there's sort of a whole bunch of methods that already exist. There is some sort of consensus on them because all of them sort of, based on different parameters, produce equally badly on some different sets. But here is sort of the human group. So they're organized in groups. They use automated tools that themselves are optimized towards best possible outcomes. And so then people together sort of reason about this consensus. Sort of saying, okay, where do we agree? Where do we disagree? What are the key things that we should focus separately? This is the key place where the scientists are actually providing feedback. So they're providing in real time feedback on this consensus, which then informs people they know what to do. And that particular feedback also feeds back to the automated methods. But perhaps the biggest thing that we've always been doing sort of semi-manually, but now we're doing fully automatically, is there's a protocol on top. There's basically a policy structure that decides how to change the interaction between people, between algorithms, how to change the timing of the stages, what should be done at which point, that is all sort of driven by the algorithm that learns from the outcomes and makes the entire structure better. So that this is one of the key things that I'd like to convey, is that oftentimes when we think of sort of how AI interacts with people, it's sort of either through sort of doing things automated that people are trying to do, or maybe putting person into the loop here. But here what we're doing is actually having the AI on top as well of the entire structure. And I think that is a very, very exciting thing. I'll show you the impact of that on education domain shortly as well. As I mentioned, sort of one of the biggest outcomes with Folded was that we kind of found a different alternate way towards expertise. And that basically from there on, I started focusing on, well, what about the general social science? Like, why can't we just learn anything? Or perhaps, why can't we just apply this to education and sort of have sort of radical changes in what actually happens in education? And then when I started looking at this problem, what became obvious is that both learning science, educational science, and sort of all the technologies that are trying to dabble in this space, we were all making the same mistake from the perspective of sort of isolating as many variables as possible and then just changing something that we think will make a difference and not just optimize that. And maybe you find some really great results, you send it out into the world, into real classrooms, and nothing happens, right? I don't know if you probably heard that there was this intelligent tutors that were being able to do this sort of significant improvement in all the experiments. And then Department of Education sent these large trials to schools, and like that signal completely disappeared when it actually goes into the real world. And so one of the key reasons is that it's a learning ecosystem. It's an extremely complex system where many things interact with each other. So a student is not a singular student, right? They come in so many shapes and sizes, and they're plastic. They change through interaction with the system. They're not just level of mastery in a particular concept, but things like affect, mindset, all belief in themselves, all of these things are actually parameter of this thing that has to be modeled. Similarly, the teacher, you know, what are the set of actions and behaviors that the teacher can do to optimize not just one student, but multiple students? Oftentimes, that's a separate entity that's never analyzed together with the actual student outcomes. Third, curriculum, right? So oftentimes we think curriculum is a book, you know, or maybe it's some online curriculum that may be slightly differentiated with some fixed structures with branching on some particular performance parameters, right? But what if we can actually custom tailor the curriculum, the problems, and even the set of knowledge to specifically fit the sort of the working memory of every individual student, for example? And finally, what is the support system at school? So the key thing for me is, how do I look at this whole system and optimize it together? So why can we not apply the standard sort of machine learning on these kinds of things? Well, first, if I look at this whole ecosystem I just described, the models don't exist. Right? If I wanted to apply some mechanics onto a robotics, I can build a model of that particular robot. I can simulate and create a huge number of samples. You can't do that for the learning ecosystem because so much is unknown and so many sort of stochastic things are in this space because there's a lot of people. Okay. The second one is that the state space is sort of orders of magnitude larger than anything that reinforcement learning algorithms or any kind of planning algorithms can deal with, right? If you imagine all the things I can change for that student, all the things I can change in the curriculum, all the things I can change for this teacher, those actions by themselves is an enormous space. And then the final one is that almost all, and this has been sort of, you know, this is sort of one of my big pet peeves, is, you know, oftentimes when you want to use algorithms in the real world, you know, the perspective of sort of researchers developing algorithms, we show that with sufficient amount of data, you know, this thing will converge towards a particular outcome. But in sort of these high stakes environments, that doesn't cut it. You can't even have a terrible problem on the day one, right? So there's this high stakes environment like education or medicine, when you need to sort of like prescribe some kind of medicine or something to somebody. You can't just explore for first 2 years, kill a bunch of people, and then maybe something will convert, right? So the key question then is how to design the algorithms that would actually be very careful about the sort of exploration sampling, and start from something reasonable, and then improve itself continuously rather than having sort of this sampling disrupt the whole process the entire time.
Okay, so those three things actually define my research frontier. So really, what I try to design is sort of a parametric synthesis of content curriculum. What that means is we're using AI mechanisms to ingest curriculum and automatically expand it 100 times, such that you have every possible variation of problem, every possible explanation or content, such that you can have very fine scalpel precision things that you present to every student. Okay? This is the second one is putting the human in a loop for model refinement. So this is one of the big things, right? So we all publish a lot of papers on algorithms, and we kind of know what we do in this process. We have an algorithm, we adjust the algorithm a little bit, but we actually adjust the model a lot more than the algorithm. We sort of change the representation here and there until we actually have the possible outcomes. But we don't necessarily write about the process of us changing the representation. We just write it as here's the good representation. But the key thing, I think, for all of those things really is oftentimes it almost doesn't matter what algorithm you use. It actually matters what your representation is. What's that?
This is a known result in around 20 years.
Okay, great. I don't need to.
But it's worth repeating because most people forget it.
Okay. sorry to if this has already been repeated during this this symposium. But the key thing is that why don't we then design algorithms that iterate and refine the model as opposed to just the algorithm?
You mean the model language or the model?
No, the entire model. So that means, what does it mean that for a state? What does it mean for actions? What does it mean for observables?
I just want to make sure we're not using the word model in some way, because we have that by the consensus. And
okay.
So what do you mean by a model?
Yeah, so basically the representation of the real world problem in a way in which
that
it can...
That's not what most of us would mean by a model. However, it's important, and I agree with you, but you're going to do that.
Okay. How would you call this thing that I'm calling a model?
Representation. Or formulation.
Okay, fine. So then what I was saying then is not repeated many times, but it's maybe novel, that representation is the key thing.
No,
The key thing then is, of course, you start with a particular model, and then how can you have people that are maybe domain experts, not necessarily machine learning experts, sort of how can they get just the right information from the machine learning or reinforcement learning such that they will provide the right changes, which then will be recomputed by the algorithms, figure out its effectiveness, and then provide additional feedback to the person for what next to change. Right? So we start with a model slash representation and of arbitrary quality, and then the system informs the person for where they should focus on what to change. The change is enacted, the quality of that change, because it may not be good, is then sort of robustly evaluated, presented to the person for additional iteration, right? And so I'm really excited about this space because I did the same thing for in another domain in sort of a program synthesis domain where it's the same thing, you know, design algorithms without forgetting about the actual modeling slash representation part. So we have just started doing this, and we actually have sort of live experiments now with thousands of kids playing this instructional material. The actual success of that is then presented to the grad students in education who are changing things. This affects things in real time for students the next day. And we're actually iterating this thing until we actually arrive at the
sort of optimal model. I'm really, really excited about this because I think it's not just reinforcement learning. I think many sort of machine learning representations can actually benefit from that kind of thing, and maybe remove some of this sort of black magic that often shrouds the quality of algorithm because it depends on the representation. And then finally, as I mentioned, the policy exploration thing. So let me just give you a little sense of what do I mean by a sort of parameterized curriculum. So let's say what we do is basically we encode the thinking processes that people need to go through in order to solve a certain set of mathematical problems. Turns out there's only 70 thinking processes in the entire K through 12 mathematics. That's because they're nested and they use themselves in a very efficient way. So then the question is, how can we take any kind of curriculum and then generate the entire space of possible problems in such a way that every edge here is a collection of problems that are in the equivalence class that are slightly harder than these problems, exactly along one dimension of possible 20 dimensions in which the curriculum becomes hard, right? So this is the structure on which you can learn, but the key thing is it's automatically generated once you encode the thinking processes that you really need to exhibit in order to solve these kinds of problems. Here's an interesting thing. If I take that particular problem and I see what jump math or Singapore math, I'll bring it with you, are actually addressing in their curriculum, you see that they have maybe like 1/5 or less of the content, right? So see, this is the entire space that should be available to students in order to learn. This is the only thing that's available to students right now. You had the question, Trent, and yeah.
Could you give an example of one of those nodes? I'm still trying to grasp.
Yeah, so a node is a sort of a type of problem where you need to think a specific way in order to solve it. Here's a type of problem where you need to, it's not a procedural problem, you actually need to test a whole bunch of different hypotheses, and there's a specific set of things you should be thinking in order to solve this kind of problem. There's an equivalence class of these kinds of problems, so we can automatically generate all problems that are in this equivalence class, but there's also problems that are slightly easier, slightly more difficult, by not using some of these principles, for example. And so basically what we're able to do is create this ontology by slowly scaffolding more and more complex problems by leading them from the simplest possible thing, which could be probably just a triangle with two angles and just an X, to something a lot more complex like this. Does that make sense? You had a question.
I don't know if you talk about that, but I'm trying to understand what is the user, what is your input, what is learned, how the reinforcement learning will play with that. How will you adapt and revise the model / representation?
Yeah.
Maybe the previous slide. It's like, what is input? Right?
Yeah, so the input is this. Okay? Just, in this case, it's a textbook. So what we do with this, we basically have, we have a special domain-specific language of thinking that we encode. What's a singular way to think, or multiple ways to think, such that you can solve not just these problems, but all the problems in this equivalent class. Then there are algorithms that do analysis of that description that sort of are able to not just create this ontology, but create exemplars of problems and thinking that need to be covered through a curriculum that would allow students from not knowing anything to be able to do. Okay, so that's just creating the initial model. Now the question is, now that I have this structure, what are the set of possible actions I can use here? What are the possible sort of logic on my traversal of this thing? Because what I really want to do is get these hardest problems here. If the students can do these, they can actually solve the actual thing. So the key question is, how do I even start with a comprehensive representation of everything that I could be exploring? And now I have a way of automatically generating the entire space. Okay, so I'll get to the other parts shortly. Here's another interesting thing we can do. Can somebody tell me what Juanita is doing wrong here? She has a consistent method of adding numbers. What's that?
She's adding the digits.
Yes.
4 plus 8 plus 3 is 15.
Yeah?
Just get 37.
Not always. Okay, so I mean, you got the basic thing. So basically, when she sees it like this, she does the right thing. Okay? When she sees something missing, she resorts back to, well, I don't understand what this means, so I'm just going to treat them as something I've seen before, which is single-digit addition, I'm just going to add them. They're just organized in this peculiar way. And so what any kind of analysis system would say, okay, she answered 2 out of 3 right. Okay? You didn't reach the mastery, you need to practice more of that. Our system basically you can basically infer their thinking process by this thing, and as a result, you say, this person has no problem adding whatsoever. The only issue is place value. So you go back to the system that's actually going to address the place value as opposed to the addition.
This is classic
right?
Student modeling. I mean, people worked on this 30 years ago. This is great, but it's not. What is new
is that the student modeling, who's going to write all possible algorithms of what the students did wrong?
People use machine learning to automatically infer student models from data like this.
I'm sorry, they're not inferring the programs. Yes. That has not been done before.
Well, I published a paper in 1984 on this.
Well, I didn't reference that paper, but I would like, how complex of a thinking process were you able to discover?
I did the multiple abstraction. So you might have something really complex.
Well, no, that's true, yeah, but I can take any possible problem in K-12 and infer the actual reasoning behind it. You have a very specific domain on which you narrow the thing.
Any problem in K-12.
Yeah, in fact, we actually now this Voyager Sopris, which is the fifth largest college in the United States, is using these algorithms for the curriculum that they're selling across the U.S.
I'm sorry, I missed that. So how do you handle all these things? You have a standard representation?
Well, like it's the algorithm basically looks at the correct thinking process and looks at all possible things that I could be doing. Other than the actual correct thing, and that basically there's a large exploration space of all possible programs that basically narrows it down with sufficient number of samples onto the most likely.
We'll talk about
scenarios.
So like stereo revision stuff for this.
Sure.
Sure.
But for everything.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well,
that's
But anyway, so the point is, once you encode this thing, you can generate the entire ontology as well as follow students' thinking in a very general way. Okay, now the other thing I wanted to mention is the tractability. So as I mentioned, tractability is a big issue. So originally we just started with machine learning algorithms. Let's just give all these parameters to it and let's figure out all the actions. And very quickly you realize that no matter what kind of, in fact we published new algorithms on novel models of clustering that could actually mitigate some of the sort of recursive dimensionality. Unfortunately, nowhere close to actually it being practical. So now what we've done is basically subdividing the problem into sort of 3 different levels of policies that interact with each other. On the first level, you can sort of think of sort of there's one concept, and when you have this concept, you can move on to the next concept. This is sort of the standard way in which most things are broken down. Here we have actually every one of these concepts breaks down into all possible ways of thinking. So now we have sort of exploded sort of the potential ways in which we can vary the content for people. And you can sort of imagine a student through a policy going through a particular place, and then at some point they're stuck. And because we know exactly what thing that they're confused on, there's an action here that sends them to a very specific thing that removes all other complexities and focuses just on the misconception that the student has, right? So the problem here is that if I'm representing this with a set of actions, which are just these edges, I couldn't make this jump. I would make some small gradual jump either backwards or et cetera. But here what you really need is all possible actions that have to do with a set of things that you're thinking about here, and what are the simplest possible things you could be targeting to address them. So the question of how to represent the set of actions ends up being really important. And I should mention, of course, is that a different person with the same policies has a completely different path through this space. And here's one thing that when we actually try this thing on 20,000 kids, where we actually wanted to look at the optimal progressions of fractional concepts. These are many different algorithms. We have basically an algorithm that can sample the quality of the policies and algorithms based on the a priori data. The reason for that is that it's too expensive to experiment on kids. So that's what this paper is on. But the key thing to note here is that zero is a random ordering of concepts, right? The shocking thing is that the expert progression is worse than random. Okay? So basically, this is what's in our textbooks. And that's not because, you know, experts were not good experts. They're brilliant people. It's just they forgot some of the dimensions because they had to simplify the problem in some particular way. The best performing adaptive thing is about 30-40% better than the best static. The static one meaning it's the same policy for every student no matter what.
And what are the bars?
The bars are the relative improvement over random policy.
Because they intersect pretty heavily between those two.
You mean in terms of the whiskers? Or
yeah.
Yeah, I mean there's a huge variation of students, so over 20,000 students. And remember, in this case we're ignoring other aspects of the students, right? So every time you have a wide population like that, you're going to have huge variation. Yeah?
So that indicates these are standard deviations, not standard errors. These are variations of the student's performance as opposed to your estimate of the mean performance, your variability over the estimate of the mean.
This is the estimate of the mean and,
right.
and the
error. But, yeah. But that's how much individual students vary?
That's right. Yeah.
Okay. So it differs than what you were thinking.
Just to understand this, do you also have a teacher that is driving decisions? Or
this one not. This one doesn't. And the final one, the level is I'll just go through this quickly. Imagine having a. So now you pick the problem. This is the problem you want to explain. There's sort of automatic explanations that happen through this system. But say this first part is almost like watching a Canon video or anything in MOOCs, right? It turns out that, you know, if you just watch a video and you try to solve the problem afterwards, nobody can do it, right? I mean, that's part of, I mean, it maybe works a little bit better for adults, but for kids, it's just completely broken. Now, what this platform is enabling you to do is to actually smoothly transition from full watching to full independence. So in this case, the system at some point stops the narration and says, now it's your turn. So it gives you more and more small little steps to do in this process until eventually, I'll just go fast forward here, eventually you see basically all the scaffolding is gone and they're just doing everything independent. So the question then for the policy is, what is the optimal way in which I will remove and introduce these set of scaffolds within the actual problem that I'm solving, such that I personalize and specialize for every individual, right? So we have actions at the skill level, actions at the problem sequencing level, and then actions at the problem support level, right? Each one of those is a completely different set of policies that need to interact with each other towards optimal outcomes. Let me just give you a sense. So you asked about the teacher. So this is the aspects of the teacher. Maybe I can play a video of that as well.
Sorry to interrupt again.
Yeah.
I mean, I do find this fascinating. I do want to talk with you, but how does this relate to the theme of the symposium?
The way in which it's related is that it's showing how these models and how actions really need to. The biggest thing that you can do for a lot of these algorithms is to provide the right set of actions in the complex system that you're trying to optimize with AI.
This is helping the students learn in class, right? This is not helping science.
Sorry. So it connects in two ways. One is basically any kind of social sciences. Well, and education is part of NSF, right? For all the important reasons. Second, there is no science that can happen without actually rapid scaffolding of people towards the high ability to perform, as I mentioned in the
earlier
part of the
earlier.
Can I give a third?
Sure.
Which is, every time you're teaching, you're trying to discover what the student's mental model is. So we are having enormous numbers of acts of discovery here. and arguably the system is doing it automatically.
And if I may give a four, in case you don't have, if we don't teach people science, they're not going to do science. That's undefeated. There is.
And you and you and you've done this in science curriculum too, not just math.
We have done, we are doing it both in biochemistry and neuroscience through the previous thing that I've shown.
The reason I ask is because the technical knowledge you need for arithmetic and algebra, and even physics problem solving, is pretty different from the kind of stuff you see in biochemistry. So if that was going there, that would be really interesting.
Well, if I may add another reason, I thought it was obvious. He started by showing folded, and you know, for.
No, I saw that.
The key reason.
I mean, there are. So you want to actually, you know, generalize how to get people engaged and how to get this human computer interaction. So, sorry, Pat, if you are missing all these beautiful connections to this workshop.
Okay.
I think I may be running out of time. Because but I welcome all the questions. I think even the controversial ones I think promote good discussion. So what I wanted to show you is that the system then is able to actually provide a set of actions for the teacher at the same time. So for example, this one basically says, you know, the student had a big breakthrough. You should give the student a high five. So you can see that's a trivial action, but it turns out that particular contact with the student. Actually, physical contact with a student is the biggest incentive as analyzed by neuroscience from the perspective of the engagement to do more. So that's embedded in this platform in order to sort of provide this. But here's some more interesting things that the platform can do. So it can, let's say, so there's a particular set of kids that are confused exactly on the same misconception. So it produces just the right curated model out of the synthesized space of possible actions in order to for this teacher to call those students and explain it to them for maximal utility. Okay? So then, again, it's a complex system. What are the best possible actions that the teacher can do in order to optimize the best outcomes of the entire community of students? All right, so how does this work at scale? So we ask the following question. How many kids can we teach how to solve for X in these kinds of problems, even in the elementary school. Okay. We conducted an algebra challenge on the entire Washington state, later on the entire country of Norway, and later on the state of Minnesota. And the interesting outcome is any classroom that participated for an hour and a half, so no cherry picking, everybody on this entire massive population, this is the percentage of the students that reached mastery, as defined by solving the equations that I showed earlier, right? So on average, 96% of all kids that participated in these challenges across all of these three populations were able to reach mastery, including kids, ignore the kindergarten, I should say, there were only three of them that were actually participating. That's not statistically significant, everything else is. So here's another thing you should know. So obviously we did another set of trials on same teacher, same curriculum, but one is on the paper, one is with our platform. And here are some interesting effects. The same teacher does three times as many individual assists to students with this platform as opposed to just teaching the same content on the paper. Not only that, but they're helping a lot more the students that are really in the need, as opposed to just sort of helping the Gaussian middle of the classroom. So it's as if we added two more teachers in the classroom for the same amount of time by providing these sort of actionable actions to teachers at the same time. Now students, it's the same kind of thing. So the students for the same amount of time were able to sort of go through four and a half times more content during the same amount of class. So not only did you need to have that much more content, you need to have that much more customized, curated content for every individual. If you also look at here, at this bottom here, these kids are not just highly advanced kids who are just zooming through, but kids who just really need to be remediated And we're getting just the right amount of more volume of the content in order to master that particular content. So, as I mentioned, we have sort of large deployments in K-5. We also have 100 million first generation learners in India using this particular platform to get basic literacy and numeracy. This is under NDA, so I can't mention who, but one of the largest assessment companies in the States is using this automatic synthesis of ontologies for their item banks for assessment purposes. And this hasn't been signed yet, but it's about to be signed. We have PBS Kids is going to run next 4 years of scientific inquiry content on this platform to specialize for every individual. So I'm really excited. Not only have we, and the reason why I've been pushing these things is that you cannot learn anything without scale here, because this system is so complex. Isolating everything individually does not lead to correct conclusions. That's sort of the key thing that I wanted to mention. And again, going backwards, how does this relate to this? The key kind of frontiers that I see is that how do we include AI in order to build actually this human-computer symbiosis architecture that's not specialized to one problem but can solve arbitrary set of problems? How can we have a new science and directly deploy this kind of approach that I've tried to sort of first manually, now semi-automatically apply to a new set of domains? The other key thing that I'm seeing, and I'm directing a lot of my research in this space, is sort of focus on, I guess I should say, representation model to make everybody happy here, but it's this design and refinement. So the idea is that oftentimes, and this actually came from my frustration of trying many different algorithms on a representation and say, well, nothing actually moves the needle at all. And then you realize, well, it's really, everything is about having the right actions in the first place. Because if you don't have them, and in many large spaces, you won't have the sort of few discrete things you can actually do. If you don't have those actions, if you can't parameterize them, it doesn't matter what you actually do and how you optimize it. And then finally, for something that's systemic, like science, that involves many different people working together, computers, groups of people, and maybe in different labs, or in education, like I mentioned, the key thing is to look at the whole thing in entirety. You can benefit more from looking at the whole system and picking some small set of variables in that system than picking many variables and just looking at one siloed thing at once. That's one of the big things that I've realized that's really sort of directed how I think about solving a lot of these problems. Thank you. That's a secondary thing. You know, I need to build sort of a lot of them. So for example, that's why I have ELA, English Language Arts, as well as math and science, because then I can actually look at sort of the transfer.
Can I text about data sharing?
Yeah.
So this would be a tremendous amount of data here that can be shared with other researchers.
Yeah, I think some of our RBs allow us to share. The problem is when you have these kind of active systems, it's not like here's the set. Everything here is active, right? So the data from that day is going to be different from the data from this day because I actually changed the whole representation in the meantime. So I'm still struggling with how I'm going to expose this to people to the extent that they will know exactly all the things of 50 things that could have changed that have changed. But I think you can actually, for that, I think a lot of people look at these secondary analysis. This secondary analysis of this would actually be more informative because many things were changed in the process. Yeah?
So if we consider that science is in fact a little bit of a game itself, with rules and kind of sub-games within any given discipline, is there some kind of synthesis of the work that you're doing with the work that someone's doing in the bioinformatics or a knowledge-based view of a specific subdomain?
last, ever since Folded, right? Is how do I now generalize this thing? How do I have other people who are trying to make the same, you know, not everybody succeeds when they started. In many ways, I feel guilty that a lot of people have started doing this kind of scientific discovery through games and not really coming with great outcomes because, you know, it took us 2 years of very active iteration in order to get that. And a lot of things about this mapping, how do you integrate scientific domain into something like that? And so when we're in this neuroscience project, it has become a lot more efficient because I've actually, you know, what often happens is when you take the domain knowledge from the scientist and you want to represent it, oftentimes it's insufficient. They don't tell you everything. Oftentimes a lot of it is not necessarily codified, it sort of exists in the lore in some way. So there's a whole iteration process of continuously adding constraints that were not previously mentioned until you actually slice the subspace just right such that people are actually producing the reasonable sort of things. And I've actually had to do that now systematically. Because with biochemists, I was frustrated, like, why didn't you tell me this half a year ago, you know, if you knew it, right? But they, you know, there's a huge amount of domain that's not in textbooks or anywhere else. It sort of exists, maybe even in different labs, right? So the question is, and the only way you can tease it out is by saying, okay, given everything you've given me, here are the solutions. You tell me what's wrong. That what's wrong will create additional constraints and sort of better definitions of what actually needs to be.
Yes, sorry. And so thanks.
Yeah.
I'm actually very excited about the things that Zoran talked about because I think that problem solving in science is very important, and the way I look at his models is that he's modeling how we do problem solving and compose steps and tasks. So I'm going to talk more about this in the talk. I decided to title it Hypothesis-Driven Data Analysis of Science Repositories because that's where we're getting the most exciting results of applying AI in science, but I'll talk about other things as well. And I decided to focus on AI challenges, so I'll talk more about AI challenges as Vasant suggested rather than results of our research, which you can find in papers or ask me about. I want to acknowledge a lot of collaborators. I think that this is a theme in science, that there's very little that we do by ourselves, and not only that I learn a lot from them about AI and about their different domains, but also I want to acknowledge community workshops and meetings like this one where I've learned tremendously from other people. So I helped organize 2 meetings for NSF, one on discovery informatics some years ago and one recently on intelligence systems for geosciences in particular. There's a program called EarthCube where there's many people interested in semantics and knowledge and actually AI. And we just got funded what's called a research coordination network to support collaborations within geosciences. So if any of you are interested, we're launching this early next year. So I want to talk about AI and scientific discovery, but from the point of view of problem solving and knowledge systems tradition. And I'll talk a little bit about what I mean by that. And then some research, recent work on capturing knowledge about data analysis strategies. So we're very interested on how scientists analyze data sets. And then I'll talk about how to capture all the knowledge that we're requiring to do that kind of reasoning in support of discoveries. And then I'll summarize all the AI challenges that I'll mention along the way. So what do I mean by the knowledge systems tradition? So, you know, I look at different work in AI, and I see that it's really having an impact very broadly in society. So you see things here that have made it to the commercial world, and they range from intelligent assistants to question answering systems to a knowledge graph that helps find the right things. And then things like recommenders and self-driving cars and robots. And I show you these examples because these are very mature technologies that are making an impact. And what I see is that there's a lot of technologies that are in what I'm calling here the data systems tradition. So there's data, and you're just trying to learn as much as possible from that data. And I think that there's another kind of tradition in AI which has more to do with problem solving and knowledge systems. And that's the part that I'm most interested in. So not discounting the importance of analyzing data, but analyzing data is one slice of the kinds of activities that I look at. So I think, sorry.
Can we go back?
Yes.
Why do you put robot teams and even cars?
Well, not that the systems above don't look at data. I'm just saying that the emphasis is more on solving a problem or doing a task or answering a question rather than doing something with the data that you're ingesting in the case of the robots. That's all. But, you know, I'm not saying that we shouldn't, there's no work that crosses both. I'm just making a point that there's a lot of tradition in terms of looking at problem solving and knowledge in AI when we look at science. So I'm looking back to a tradition that was started by these people. How many of you recognize the picture on the top left? Some of you do, right? I think I could predict which ones of you would recognize it. Right? So they started a whole tradition of looking at science and how do scientists actually look at data, look at knowledge, reason about what they see, and try to solve new problems and try to test hypotheses and try to revise hypotheses. So that's the kind of tradition that I'm thinking about in my work. So I want to talk about some work that we've done recently on capturing knowledge about how scientists analyze data and pursue certain hypotheses. So this is work that's joined with a group at Stanford. They're actually cancer omics experts, but they are very good at explaining and articulating how they go about solving problems. So we're working with them to figure out what happens if they were able to tell a system, this is what I'm interested in, and the system went off and tried to find data that is currently available in repositories. There's a lot of omics repositories. And in particular in cancer, there's the Cancer Genome Atlas and CPTAC that have extensive, well-documented, and carefully collected data about many, many patients, and they keep growing over time. So what if we told the system, I'm interested in this, and keep track of this data and analyze it, and then tell me when you find something interesting. We call them Friday meetings, Friday as in Robinson Crusoe's Friday, that would actually tell you once a week on Fridays, you know, these are the exciting things that I have found out that I think you would be interested in. And our approach is to really capture the data analysis strategies that the scientists are using in the domain. So we build on work that we did in the past on looking at data analysis workflows where each step of the workflow is a piece of software that you run as some analytic software or analytic step or maybe data reformatting or data preparation or data integration step. So that's how we're able to capture a lot of the problem solving process. So we look at how they go through this cycle of given a hypothesis, find data, figure out how to pursue the analysis or the testing of the hypotheses, finding a method, running some of these workflows, some of these data analysis, and then look at the results and decide what are the implications for the hypotheses. And when we look at this, we know it's inefficient. We know that each of them installs a software, has to learn how to set parameters, has to look for data. They don't know how to do certain steps, so they read some papers, they find out. It's a very inefficient process. So science is a really bad business, really inefficient business. It's very incomplete, so they'll analyze data that they happen to know about or pursue methods that they're familiar with rather than the best ones available. It's also irreproducible, so we heard this morning about reproducibility problems, which are very pervasive. And also it's very one-shot. So I publish a paper analyzing the data that were available on that day, or at the time when I did the studies, but then if more data is available that could help enhance or refute or support better the hypotheses, that's hardly ever done. So it's very one-shot kind of analysis. So all of these are problems with the way that science is currently done. So what we're trying to do is capture data analysis strategies through what we call lines of inquiry. So you have a hypothesis, and scientists typically have their specific methods or approaches or strategies to pursue those hypotheses. So in our case, if they have cancer data, they'll say, well, if you're asking about a specific protein affecting a kind of cancer, I'm going to look for patients that have that kind of cancer. I'm going to look for lab data from tissue from those patients. And I'm going to prefer mass spec data to fluorescence data to look at proteins. And if I have microarray data, I'll use it. And if it's different groups of patients, I might prefer the proteomic data. And if I have the same patients, so they have all these approaches to pursue this. And we're trying to capture that kind of problem solving. So these lines of inquiries have queries that describe what kind of data is relevant to that type of hypothesis. They have workflows that tell us how to analyze that data. And then they have what we call meta workflows, which decide how the results of the data analysis affect the hypotheses. So you may have evidence from different sources, and you combine that evidence through the meta workflows. So to give you some examples, these are just pictures to show you that they have many different kinds of data analysis that they can do, and they vary very much. There's many different algorithms out there, but there's a general kind of analysis that they can articulate to us and we can capture. There's also very typical ways to combine evidence from all these data sources. And in fact, in some cases, if you have proteomics data from a group of patients and genomics data from a very different group of patients, you might not really know how to combine the evidence. So that's also something that our meta workflows understand. So just to summarize, we start with the hypothesis. We look at what lines of inquiry are appropriate for that hypothesis. We've had to do a lot of thinking about how to handle alternative lines of inquiry, how to handle lack of data, incompatible or data that we don't know how to combine. The line of inquiry also tell us what workflows to trigger and then what meta workflows to use to combine the results. And the result of all this process could be a revision of the initial hypotheses. We also attach some confidence values based on the results, and also data that results from all this analysis, and a detailed provenance trace of how that was generated. So we've worked on this with data from a seminal cancer omics paper. We're running this through terabytes of data. It's a paper that combines expertise from many different people. It took them 6 years to figure out how to do this analysis, and they did this for colon cancer. So now we have captured the entire problem-solving process that we can apply to new data very easily. So one of the challenges in terms of representation is representing the hypotheses and how they evolve over time, and the entire provenance of and derivation of any new hypotheses and conclusion. And one of the exciting things we're working on is generating in English the method section of the paper. And actually it's a customized method section. So if you're a PI, you get the high level highlights. If you're a developer, you get the low-level software details, and if you're a scientist, a biologist, you might get the view on the data that was used and the significance and so on. So it's a very exciting project. And the kinds of problems that we've been able to address, and there's some papers that you can find here about this. One is that if you want to integrate data from different instruments or different sources of evidence for some hypotheses, this is really hard, and you have to combine a lot of different expertise in these workflows and meta workflows. And the other problem that has been interesting is how, if your data keeps growing and there's data from more patients or new types of data that become available, that can really affect your prior hypotheses. So I mentioned earlier that these studies are usually done once, and then the paper's published, and then they're shelved. So they're shelved. So we want to be able to revise these hypotheses over time. So I refer you to those papers for details, but the kinds of AI challenges that we see ahead are many. How can we make this work across disciplines? So we've been talking to geoscientists naturally, and they have a lot of commonality, but also some differences in their problem-solving strategies. The hypothesis representation and evolution is another challenge. Having the right meta reasoning strategies, how to prioritize what kind of data to analyze, aggregating evidence from diverse types of data, generating explanations that are appropriate for the scientists, learning to improve from user feedback. So if the scientist says, yeah, that's good, but I'm not very interested in those kinds of data or that kind of analysis, or I don't trust that algorithm or anything. Identifying what's interesting in the results, so our system could run off and do a lot of analysis and do updates to the confidence of hypotheses, but when is a result interesting to report to a scientist and bother them with what the system is finding out? And also designing new data analysis methods. So this is an area where I think what Zoran was talking about is very interesting, because we can capture a lot of steps, and so maybe we have new ways to combine those steps to discover new methods that may be more effective. And then finally, all the things that I've described, we're putting pieces of software and describing some constraints in them, but we're really not capturing models or theories of the science. So our system doesn't know what a protein is and how it interacts with a gene or anything like that. And so without that, it's very hard for it to formulate new hypotheses or really do very creative science research. So that's, I think, a huge area of work. So I think that these are exciting results in an exciting direction, but of course it requires a lot of knowledge about the data. We have to know that the data is from a patient that had, you know, a certain type of cancer. We have to know that it was done with a certain lab instrument and it generated mass spec data. We have to know a lot of details about how. So how do we make sure that we capture information about the data, the software, the methods, the meta-analysis? So we have worked in all of these areas with a range of projects, and I just want to give you a glimpse of the kinds of AI challenges that we have found. So when we talk about understanding data, scientists call this metadata. So they don't want to provide metadata. I think we heard that this morning from Michelle, right? It's the last thing they want to do. They'd rather, as Carol Goebel would say, share their toothbrush than you know, put a lot of work into sharing their data. So we're working with paleoclimatologists that have 70,000 records that they cannot use because there's no metadata for them. There's papers and there's little notes, but so we want them to be able to annotate them as they do research, and we're developing semantic wikis that help a community converge to a shared vocabulary to describe these records. They don't want to go to meetings, they just want to do their science and structure the metadata as much as they can, but then the system's supposed to help them organize all of that metadata. So there's a lot of AI opportunities here in terms of guiding the collection of metadata. So if there's someone who has provided a lot of information about the genus of the corals, they should be routed questions about the genus of the corals, normalizing things. So if they use different terms to refer to the same thing, our systems could detect it and normalize the use of vocabulary, and then organizing the entries, the data sets, and detecting common properties that could point to classes of sediments or classes of objects in the domain. So what we end up doing is, and Michelle talked about it this morning, is we have within our project to describe some particular kind of core, sediment core. And so we start to point to other sources. So for example, we could use the Palmyra Atoll was the location. We can get that from Wikidata. So we just point through a URI to the atoll entry from Wikidata. If we have oxygen on isotopes, those are terms that are in linked data on RDF on the web. If we need to talk about what is a sediment core, there's an ontology for that. And so we start to gather pointers and link to other resources that describe information that's relevant to these particular paleoclimatologists. So I think this is a very exciting thing to do with describing data. In terms of describing software, we've done a lot of work on understanding what scientists care about in terms of software. They care about what language is implemented in and the installation instructions, but they care a lot more about assumptions that the software makes and where to get data that helps them calibrate the model and so on. So there's a lot of AI opportunities in terms of characterizing software, characterizing the algorithms, organizing them into classes and categories, and also linking software to data. So right now, scientists have data repositories over here and software repositories over there, if we're lucky, and they're not really very well connected. Which brings me to talk about workflows. So these workflows are methods that tell you how the data is processed by software. And so we've done a lot of work on characterizing not just all the steps of the workflow, but also knowledge about when the methods apply, when the steps apply, how to set parameters. So we have done a lot of work on how to add constraints to these workflows. And there's a lot of AI opportunities in terms of abstractions from these methods so that they don't depend on having the MATLAB implementation of this step, that you could use any implementation of this step. So there's a lot of work to do on abstraction, mining to figure out common sub-workflows that are pervasive so they can be easier and easily reused, and then composing pieces of these workflows. So a lot of topics in planning and problem solving for sure. We've also looked a lot at provenance, so executions of these methods, executions of these workflows. This is crucial for explanation, for being able to reuse methods, to be able to update results if the software had a bug and is updated, anything like that. So there's a lot of useful opportunities. And then in terms of meta processes, we've also been looking at how do they decide what analysis is relevant in the first place, what data is relevant to a question in the first place. So we've been doing a lot of work on a project that we call Organic Data Science, where we're supporting collaboration, formation of groups, and really keeping track of having a healthy community that has the scope needed to address a question. And again, interlinking all these types of knowledge. So we try to link our workflows to the software, to the data, to meta workflows, and create a healthy and very distributed environment where the data and the information is coming from in science. And in this respect, there's a lot of AI opportunities. So Michelle talked about some of these this morning. So interlinking this information, analyzing what pieces are better quality, worse quality, what's more reliable, and then recommender systems that can tell a scientist, you seem to be using a lot of X, you might like Y. And so recommending data sets or software or other things. Another thing that we're doing to capture data and knowledge about science is promoting what we're calling the scientific paper of the future, where we train scientists and we have special issues of journals where they learn to document the data sets, place DOIs and URIs to the source data, same thing for the software, describe metadata, describe workflows and provenance. So scientists themselves can do a lot to improve the way they write papers. And my goal is to use these papers, papers of the future, to help AI systems get a glimpse of what these papers are about and what methods are they using, and to be able to reuse them for other things. So I'll end with a summary of the AI challenges that I already mentioned. So I see a lot of knowledge representation challenges, and I realize these are very simple compared with really truly representing scientific knowledge, like models and scientific knowledge. But we just want knowledge about what the data is representing, what the software is doing, how to combine the software together. So really the more mechanical parts of the data analysis process, because we think that's where a lot of low-hanging fruit resides. And then in terms of problem solving itself, how to use all of this knowledge that we can capture to do hypothesis-driven discovery. So I mentioned a lot of challenges. I think some of the more interesting ones are figuring out how to represent the very broad variety of strategies that scientists use, and yet they have a lot of good commonalities. So how do we do this in a way that's domain independent? And I'll finish here. Go ahead.
So one of the sort of the new opportunity in the genomic era is that we can simultaneously explore a lot of hypotheses. So I'm curious, like, what does it take? Well, like, for example, every one of the 20,000 genes. And so I'm curious, what would it take to sort of expand from this hypothesis-driven framework to actually be able to prioritize hypotheses rather than have to start from a concrete hypothesis?
Right. So I explained here with examples with one hypothesis, but in fact, our hypotheses can have many statements, and we can assign confidence values to pieces of those statements and combined statements. So we use semantic web technologies, we use RDF and OWL to annotate the hypotheses. So we can actually do nice things like taking a whole set of statements, create a graph with it and associate a confidence value on that, and then make revisions to that over time. So that's definitely in the books. When I ask them, why can't we just analyze data and find new hypotheses, their response is that there's just too many possibilities. So I think that what I see is that they want to do a very much guided process that's focused on the things that I am interested in or the topics that I want to look at, right? Otherwise, we're in the situation of, I think it came up this morning, right? It's a system that generates possible hypotheses, but no one wants to look at it. You know, look at those hypotheses and test them, right? I think Peter was bringing this up, right? So I think we have to make the systems work on things that the scientist cares about. So.
You indicate here, and I think other people in this room agree, that there is some sort of master model that you can make of understanding. If you do that, will you channel people so they won't be able to go out of those models in order to be effective? And are there differences within particular working groups in their relative areas of discovery and development and maturity and so forth that wouldn't fit some of these models? Would you then be able to provide some latitude instead of making the assumption that everybody has to go down the same tunnel?
Right, that's a very good question. So I think we're focused on relatively simple tasks, and I think that we are both working with scientists ourselves, but also looking at cognitive science literature where, for example, the scientists in a lab are studied to understand what are the strategies that they follow, how they pursue hypotheses, how they write papers. So I think that there's something in the area of the slice of science where you're doing data analysis. And I think, we've been looking at geoscience methods to analyze hydrology models. And there, they also have hypotheses that we can fit in our framework. But their strategies are combinatorially more challenging than these. And so I think that there's some places where we can have relatively shorter term impact and other places where it will take additional capabilities to what we have today. And others where, you know, they'll be beyond this place of data analysis probably.
So nice talk, Yolanda. So you, I think when you were talking about the hypothesis evolution, this really struck me. And a couple of things that I'd like to hear from you. One is the potential generalizability of a hypothesis that is evolving in one domain and potentially its application in another. Like when we look at these workflows, we have difficulty imagining that this is generalizable to a different problem. I mean, they are just so specific to the data, to the method. Can they be transposed to or applied in any fragmented way even to other domains? And then the second bit is you emphasize this idea of reproducibility. And so if the hypotheses are evolving, and maybe they're evolving as a result of exposure to data or data that's brought in, how can we, like, Can we retrospectively apply that to sort of say, would we be able to answer this question if that data set wasn't there? And can we account for that? Can we amend the hypothesis and the execution system to still answer a question accurately?
Yeah. So in fact, we did work with Oregon Health and Science University, their cancer center, where they have a clinical use of workflows to annotate patient data. So they have genomic data and they need to annotate what are possible, you know, drugs that won't work very well given their genomic profile and given what is known about those genes, right? So if the patient is treated today and they come back in 6 months, they may want to know how come I was not given this treatment or how come I was given this treatment. So they have to very much track exactly what data was used at the time and what was known and what was in the data sources. So I think as the data evolves, it's, you know, there's lots of scenarios and reasons to understand what was known at the time. So I forgot your other question.
The first one was just generalizability and transposability.
Oh,
of these
so for these methods, so for example, I stare at genomics methods and they're doing a lot of clustering, for example. They apply a lot of, you know, PCA and statistics. So there just seems to be a lot of room for, you know, if I really knew that this was doing a certain type of clustering and, you know, Andrew discovers a new clustering algorithm, I could just plug it in and see how that works. Maybe that changes, you know, maybe that rocks the world. So I do think that there's a lot of pieces that seem to be, in terms of data analysis and statistics, pretty general.
Well, but I would worry. I guess I'm sure many aspects of a workflow can be reused, but I would worry that somebody crafted certain aspects of your colon cancer or whatever it was workflow for colon cancer, and that you try to apply it to skin cancer, and there are things that an expert would want to tweak. And maybe there are ways to make that happen, but you're going to need a lot more knowledge in the workflow about the assumptions behind why it was designed the way it was.
Right. I agree.
Hospital workflow.
Oh.
Are you currently doing the intervention and the decision, or are you basically tracking perhaps for the in the future you do?
So I'm not doing it, they're doing it. They just have our system set up. And what they do is they generate a report for the patient for the clinician. So the clinician is the one that makes the decisions. We just augment the patient's genome with additional information.
All right, so my name is Kevin Kostin, and I'm going to talk a little bit about how AI and humans might work together in citizen science in the future. And since we have Zoran here, we've had an amazing example of citizen science in the form of Foldit. The stuff I'm talking about is much, much less interesting, so I'm going to try to talk about it much quicker. But basically, it's in response to things like this, which people probably recognize as the Sloan Digital Sky Survey. So in many areas of science, data are being generated at an increased rate because of automation in the data collection. And so that leads to lovely, beautiful pictures like this and research questions that could be answered by this kind of large-scale data analysis. The problem is that, at least at the time the project started, the ability to machine process these things wasn't very advanced, and so that basically meant having a human look at it, which led to this particular project, which I'm sure everyone in the room has heard of, Galaxy Zoo, a citizen science project to analyze galaxies, asking a set of very, very simple questions. You know, what shape is it, which way does it rotate, things like that. The people who created this, Chris Lintott and Kevin Swanowski, a postdoc and a PhD student at Oxford, thought that they might get a couple dozen people to help out, and that, you know, they could get through the images in a year or so. They were quite astonished in the first days of the site when it immediately crashed because of the number of visitors. And it led to a curve like this, which is the number of classifications being done per hour. And it's just 48 hours across. And within the first 12 hours of the project, the volunteers were doing as many classifications as had been in the largest survey ever published up until that point, which was 10,000. And then within 2 days, they were doing as many classifications in an hour as the PhD student had done in the previous month. So basically, his previous month of work was replicated in 2 days by the volunteers. Not completely replicated, of course, because to get the data quality, you have the volunteers do multiple classifications. So you might have 15 classifications done by a volunteer. But even so, it gives you something about the ability of citizen science to mobilize massive numbers of volunteers to do this sort of classification. The problem is that the data deluge continues. This is a picture. Actually, anyone recognize this one? So I'm not talking to a room full of astronomers, which is interesting. So this is the large-scale synoptic telescope. It's one being built in Chile that'll come online in a couple of years. It will take a complete picture of the night sky every 3 days, meaning that every night it will generate about a terabyte of data, about 10,000 images. So that's just way more images than people will be able to deal with. So of course, in this room, the obvious solution to that would seem to be AI. And in fact, things like this result indicate that the ability of AI to deal with images has gotten way, way better since Zooniverse was launched. And in particular, I find this one a very interesting one because it's an article reporting on a machine learning system that actually does better than humans. And the reason it does better than humans is that it can pick out the species of animals or plants at a level beyond what most humans can do. So it can actually pick those things up better. Of course, it also makes a lot of mistakes. And one of the reasons why it's interesting to still think about keeping humans in the loop is the opportunity for serendipitous discoveries, like this green blob here that you can see attacking this beautiful galaxy. Actually, anyone know the green blob?
So again, it's like a protein structure.
So it's, aside from the fact that it's like 100,000 light years across, so this thing is called, so what this is the best guess for what this is a quasar echo. So the idea is that in that galaxy over there, until say 10,000 years ago, there was a quasar that was illuminating this cloud of gas, and the quasar has since gone off, so we don't see the quasar anymore, but the gas is still glowing from the light. And this thing, which was a unique object when it was discovered, is called Hannes Voorwerp, which is the Dutch word for Hannes object, named after Hanny van Arkel, who is a Dutch school teacher and a Zooniverse volunteer who was the first one to identify this object. So the fact that there were humans looking at all of these images made it possible to have these sort of serendipitous discoveries. And so we have this interesting conundrum where we have more data than we have people to look at it, but at the same time, having people look at it provides the opportunity for discoveries that were not actually planned as part of the original project. So what we wanted to do was to explore the way that we could actually make productive use of both humans and machines in citizen science projects, where we could get the benefits of the machines doing what they do well and the humans doing what they do well. And we're doing this in the context of LIGO, which is the Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory. It's actually two observatories. Designed to detect gravitational waves. They're both these L shapes, about 4 kilometers long, one in Washington State, one in Louisiana. And the idea is that gravitational waves, which are caused by basically things like black holes or neutron stars moving around each other, distort the fabric of space-time. So all of space-time kind of bulges in and out. And as it does, the lengths of the arms will change ever so slightly. And so the detectors are just astonishingly sensitive. They can detect a change, a relative change in the length of the arms of 1/1000th the diameter of a protein, so 10 to the minus 21. The fact that they're so sensitive means that not only can they detect these gravitational wave events, which at best predictions will happen about once a month, they can also detect lots and lots of terrestrial disturbance, some of which is external, like seismic events, water rushing over dams nearby, trucks driving nearby, planes going overhead. All of those things will set it off, as well as lots of things inside the detector where, you know, this enormously complicated machine, something oscillates against something else. And so it can detect, it actually did detect gravitational waves. This is the gravitational wave event. You can see it has this nice sort of curve shape when you plot frequency against time. And that's what it looks like just as a amplitude against time. So what's happening basically is there are these two black holes that are orbiting each other, creating kind of a sine wave. And as they get closer, the sine wave gets faster and louder. So you get this sort of characteristic amplitude and frequency swoop. But these are the glitches. So for each one of the gravitational wave events, there are literally millions and millions of other kinds of noise that are created inside the detector. And the thing is that they come in a variety of characteristic shapes. With common causes. If you can identify what kind of a glitch it is, you can first of all take it out of the data so it doesn't confuse the analyses, but you can also hopefully try to track down the root cause in order to fix it. So what we have created is a citizen science project called Gravity Spy. And this is just to give you a sense of how many glitches there are and how often they happen. So this is 18 months worth of data, so you can see it's just like lots of glitches. So we have a citizen science project where we have the list of glitches that we know about, and people are shown a picture of it and they're asked to classify it. So far this is just basically like most citizen science projects. But as I said, we wanted to explore how you could actually use machine learning as part of that. So a number of machine learning people at Northwestern basically took on the challenge and using some of the deep learning techniques as in the Microsoft paper I showed you, we're able to come up with a system which does an okay job of trying to do the classification. And we built it in basically at the start. So we get the glitches from LIGO, we run them through the ML model. The model tries to classify them. The problem is that, as I said, we've got about 20 kinds of glitches we know about, but there's a very large number of glitches which are none of the above. And also glitches which are likely to be of a class that we haven't actually figured out yet. You know, some other cause, some other problem going on in the machine that we're trying to debug. So some of them, the machine will classify with very high confidence as being whatever it is, the ones over on the left, for example. But then others, you know, that's not really the glitch of the class it is. It's just that we don't really have a class for that one, and so it's shoved it in as best it could. So the idea is that we can actually use the machine learning to route the images in a slightly more interesting way. And one of the things we can do is we can take images that the machine has classified with very high confidence and give them to beginners as training, so that people who are trying to learn all the different kinds of glitches in the system can actually start off with glitches which are almost certain to be of a given class, and actually of only a couple of classes. So you don't have to master all 20 at the same time. You can just master a couple. So this is actually what you would see if you were to go to the site now and log in, which I invite you to do, gravity-spy.org. It would, instead of starting you off with all 20 classes, it would just give you two of them, and then basically track your performance on those two. Once you've mastered those two, it would introduce another four, and then eventually you would have all 20. So the idea is to basically scaffold people as they, I don't know if scaffold's the right word, to move people through a set of images that will help them to learn. However, it's also still useful to the system because the machine learning is not perfect. And in fact, because we have these glitches which are not of any of the known classes, you know, that the system is still trying to classify, it happens even at the beginner level that you'll be shown something which really isn't any of those images. So even the beginner human effort is helpful in verifying that the machine learning got it right and correcting it. And what it means is that that we can actually get away with a lot fewer than 15 classifications for these. You know, just one or two beginners agreeing is probably enough to retire the image. At some point, the machine learning might be good enough that you could actually just do that directly, but until then, having the human check it is still good. The second thing, though, that we're going to be doing with the volunteers is to deal with these none of the aboves. So these are a bunch of glitches which don't really fit any of the known classes, but which there seems to be enough regularity, they happen often enough, that that we want the volunteers to start collecting those together. And we're actually quite inspired by some of the work on Folded, especially with teams, trying to think about ways that you can have humans collaborating. But in addition, we also want to think about ways to use the vision, the machine vision processing to support that process. So things like, for example, having the humans put together a small collection of images they think go together, and then having the system search for other ones that match that, and build up the collection partly with human mode, partly with the machine mode. Another possibility might be doing some unsupervised clustering, having the machine propose clusters and then have the humans basically curate those. And as I said, we're also quite interested in ways that you can have collaborations where the machine and a group of people are working together in order to try to come up with these new classes. And we've actually had one success. We have R4 Warp, which is a glitch called Paired Doves, which was actually discovered in the system as it is without any particular support. So people are able to do it. We're hoping to support them so they can do it better, but people can do it now and are apparently interested in doing it. So this was discovered by a volunteer named Ekru Elme, who turns out to be a Hungarian complex systems researcher who lives in Martinique. So kind of a small world that someone from Hungary ends up in Martinique working on gravity waves. And the reason that this one is so interesting, you might actually be able to guess, is because it actually has that kind of swoopy shape. And so there's a big fear that this kind of thing would interfere with the search for the gravitational wave events because it sort of looks like one. So in fact, this is now part of the system, and that's part of the work that we have to do is to close that loop so that when volunteers do make these new discoveries, they get institutionalized, they get sent to LIGO for their analysis, but they actually get added to the citizen science system and also to the machine learning so that we have this new category of thing that people can start looking for. Lastly, the system not only collects the gravitational strain data, which is what I'm showing you here, but also something like 100,000 channels of other data. And that 100,000 channels of other data can be very important for diagnosing the cause of the glitches. So not just that the glitches look alike, but they actually have some kind of common cause that you can tell by the fact that it's coincident with something else going on inside the detector. And just as an example of that, this is a manual analysis that was done by one of the LIGO engineers. They had a bunch of glitches, which were these 50 hertz ones. You can see because they're happening at about 50 hertz. And when they collected together a group of these, they were able to notice that these ones correlated in time with a particular signal that was recorded in the system, in this case, an air compressor turning on. And so basically, there's this coincidence that when the air compressor turns on, you have a glitch in the detector. And sure enough, someone goes out and looks at the air compressor and discovers that the isolation pad is broken down. So basically, the air compressor turns on, it sends a jolt into the ground, creates a glitch. And so next time they do maintenance, they fix that, get through to the glitch. So what we ultimately want to support is that ability also for the volunteers to be able to come up with a set of glitches that they think look alike, but then use some kind of tools, which we have no idea what they look like at this point, to look through all of those other channels of data in order to be able to formulate hypotheses about the cause of the glitch. To test those hypotheses, maybe to refine the definition of the glitch based on the kind of coincidences they find, then ultimately feed that back to LIGO to say, you know, it looks like you got a problem with your air compressor that's creating this category of glitch. So in the end, we'll have a system which takes in beginners, uses the machine learning advice in order to train them about how to do the task, but ultimately supports more advanced volunteers in doing discovery of new kinds of phenomena. By looking for things that initially just, you know, have some phenomenological resemblance to each other, but ultimately to actually be able to explore the data and to test those hypotheses And that's giving us this nice symbiosis between the humans being able to guide the discovery, but using the machines to deal with the very large volumes of data that are generated. So with that, maybe I'll conclude, take some questions. More, get back on schedule.
So thanks for the talk. Whenever I see a crowdsourcing or citizen science kind of a project, I notice one thing that it's more applicable to images, and people are more willing to label or gather label data for images. I find it very hard to do it in natural language processing as such. I've tried going to Mechanical Turk, and the quality of data we get is pretty bad. I was wondering if you have any intuition or...
So, I don't have a slide in this talk, but so I should have mentioned that this was, actually I should mention first it was done with support from NSF, thank you, and also that it was done with cooperation with the Zooniverse project, which has developed, you know, 40 some odd citizen science projects, and by the way, for those who are interested, they now have a project builder where you can basically fill out a form describing the kind of questions you want, upload a data set, and you have a Zooniverse project. One of the projects, a number of the projects they have are actually in more like what you would call digital humanities, where they have people transcribing written documents. And those have actually been moderately successful. They attract, you know, a good crowd and get reasonable data quality. One is called Old Weather, transcribing ship logs in order to get basically weather data from the World War I. So using those for longer time climate change. That one's also interesting because, again, the same sort of serendipity that in addition to the routine position and weather, there are reports about events that are going on. So someone was using those and was able to identify the flow of Spanish flu as flu starts showing up in the ship reports. Another one is called Letters from Shakespeare, and it's basically people transcribing Elizabethan letters. So so people have been able to make those work well. A hypothesis is that there's a different motivational structure between Mechanical Turk and the citizen science, and that the citizen scientists are actually more motivated by the task and are therefore more likely to be concerned about getting things right as opposed to doing it quickly. So it may be that if you rethought it not as a work for pay, but as a scientific endeavor, you might get better results.
Okay, thank you.
Having said that, there's also a few around sound, and those tend not to work quite so well for reasons I could go into. Were you going to ask a question?
I was just going to ask, the thing that I'm curious about is sort of the level of increased ability by people as they go through a set of things, and what kind of feedbacks they use, not just for the initial scaffolding that you have there for different kind of patterns, but sort of more later in terms of what mechanisms and how do they self-select to. Because eventually, some people are just amazing, others are...
Right. You raise a bunch of really, really interesting questions, some of which we are still looking at. So, for example, in a few weeks, we're going to actually run an experiment to see whether the training regime does anything for either motivation or accuracy. Because we are doing the tracing of ability in order to know when to promote somebody, we actually do have accuracy scores, and so... So we actually do have some data about that, or will have eventually. The kind of feedback is actually an interesting problem because we do give feedback based on standard data that have been analyzed by the experts. There is a interest in how you could use the machine learning results to give feedback. There's a very, very grave fear of building in sort of reinforcing biases, that if the machine learning is a little bit wrong and you use it to give feedback, that you might basically end up with volunteers who are making the same mistakes that machine learning is, as opposed to making their own mistakes. So, and then this question about what to do in the longer term, we have not really addressed, and so that's actually something that we need to be thinking about. Our focus has been on, you know, training people through the first 600 or so classifications, at which point we sort of turn them loose and say that they're experts, but...
they have to go through 600.
It takes 6 to get promoted from the first level. It takes about 15 to get promoted from the second level. It takes about 60 or 70 to get promoted to the third level. And then there's a fourth level there's a fifth level that you can get promoted to, which is what we're thinking of as the precondition to be invited to do the clustering. That takes like 1,500 or so.
Thank you.
Anyway, thanks.
In our project, it's just visualization. There are a few citizen science projects that are around sound, like listening to bats.
But for the gravitational.
Yeah, no, we're just doing it with the visualization. We have, but it has been suggested to do the sound, but we haven't done it.
But do you know?
Sorry.
Thank you. So good afternoon. I'm Clara Nashtad, and I'm a professor in computer science at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. And I'm going to present a little bit of a different dimension to, I think, the topics that have been discussed here. This is going to be about materials and semiconductor fabrication data and acceleration of this particular science sort of from a different context and where AI fits here. This is supported by the NSF ACI program. So where we started to come from, looking at material science and semiconductor fabrication data, is that the President Obama's administration came up with this US Materials Genome Initiative. And one of the major results of this particular initiative was to really decrease the gap between developing of new materials and then using these materials in semiconductor fabrication development. Currently, the difference between the material being developed and being then used by the semiconductor industry is 30 years. So acceleration of that kind of science and the gap was major goal, besides other sort of aspects. So in order to do that, some of the major goals for this particular initiative, material semiconductor digital data collection needs to happen, then data curation, correlation, data analytics, data sharing, and data visualization, and so a lot of the techniques that were discussed here. So I want to just briefly describe to you what kind of processes and data these particular two communities that maybe might be next to each other in terms of physical space, but virtual they are very, very far apart. First of all, when you have material scientists, they actually take various chemical components, elements, and then use a microscope under which actually they are then observing the data and what basically the material substances are. When you look at the semiconductor fabrication process, there actually the researchers are taking different devices. If it is the ellipsometer, then the scanning electronic microscope, then also transmissional electronic microscope. They go from one device to another, and then as they are growing the various layers of the chips of the devices, then they are studying actually various properties of these particular devices and the chips that they are building. And in each of these levels, as they are looking for chips that have that withstand, for example, high temperatures, high pressure, and so on, they are looking at different materials. Very often, because these material informations are not available digitally, or they are only available through publications in very, very limited fashion, they often redo the research that material scientists have been doing. The various data that both of these communities are collecting, since they are both working with microscopes, but sort of doing different things, usually you will get very multimodal type of data. Under these scientific instruments, they get images, then very often they capture in their paper book experimental setting, how long that particular experiment, how long that particular growth of the material has been done, under what temperature, and then they have actually in their notebooks what is currently the process, oxidation depth, oxidation layer, and so on. So we are dealing with very structured type of data, the experimental setting with images and with free text. The structural settings and the text have been all in air paper books. So the current status actually was really, really fascinating to us when we started this project 3 years ago. A lot of notebooks have been used both in material science and in the clean rooms where you are developing semiconductor devices at universities, for example. Very poor documentation of results. When you take a multi-million dollar microscope, there is a PC, and the PC is not connected very often to the network. And so what the particular researchers are doing, they take a memory stick and then put basically that all the data that they are collecting on that particular flash drive. Here is actually a statistic we have been surveying, material research lab, and then also micro nanotechnology lab. What is the number of people that are using flash drive? As you can basically see, around 96% are using flash drive. Only 4% actually do look at maybe, let's use box, let's do some, if there is a connectivity. A very, very small number. And then actually, because the flash drives have very limited number of space, very often during the lab session, a lot of the scientific data get deleted and thrown away. Only the best publishable type of data is being basically stored. So imperfect data is discarded. And data is only correlated through publication. And there actually, as we interviewed the researchers, the scientists basically will tell us that's a very, very, very small number of information. So the effect is actually the data between the material science and the scientific and the semiconductors is not well correlated. The novel device prototypes in the semiconductor industry are very difficult to reproduce. And of course, the previous experiments in the deposition system may affect the subsequent experiments and reproducibility understanding of the results is really so not good. So the big question for us was actually, how do we accelerate pace of material science and semiconductor fabrication? And we felt that when one accelerates at multiple levels, one has to accelerate actually what is happening at the scientific instruments, the lab sessions. We basically observe the various scientists. They spend tremendous amount of time. Actually, they have hour at their microscope, which is around 100 bucks per hour, and half of them, they are spending only on conversion and storing things into this particular flash drive. Make it easy to curate multimodal data once you actually get it into a particular digital storage archives, repositories. And then basically enable correlation of the metadata, the material science semiconductor, using AI techniques to enable easy and faster, as we were discussing here. So we actually developed a first system that is now available in the GitHub, and various labs are now starting to use it. And that is actually has three components. One component at the microscope level, you actually get connected to the microscope PCs through high-speed networks to a cloud infrastructure, and then actually also in their offices, the scientists can access and visualize, curate, and retrieve the particular data. So a couple of very important aspects through this particular system called FORCEED has come up. One is acceleration through understanding the user processes and data models. And there was a lot of sort of discussion about representations. One of the really important aspects for talking to material scientists and semiconductor fabrication people was to actually provide the nested type of data representation, collection, data sets, files, because the current system has basically just flat type of data structure, file systems, and just was dismal. So
type of infrastructures that they feel comfortable and so on. Second thing that I mentioned, the acceleration had to happen also, what happens at the lab microscope space. And there actually we created some of the uploader capabilities that the scientist actually has available like a smart drop box. Because the particular scientist actually can either create or select on the remote cloud type of selection, a collection of the data, organize the particular space where his or her experiment is conducted. Then actually we provide capabilities that you can choose templates, pairs of data, key value sort of pairs, you can enter metadata, or we provide metadata templates, particularly for novices. And then basically the researcher just uploads the data into the file. And here, just want to sort of say, we speed up the process by 50%. So the advisors, for example, who are paying for all the sessions at the Microsoft are saving now quite a bit of money, because the students and the researchers are now basically getting much, much more data and are moving raw data actually into these collections where they will get processed. I mentioned that these user templates are very, very useful. Very often senior researchers actually provide these templates, and then you actually either just basically get told, here are basically some temperature and so, and then you just add value to that. We felt particularly for the novice students. Actually, many of the material scientists would tell us a PhD takes 5 to 6 years in materials or in semiconductor, and the first 2 years actually the problem is because you make mistakes. You don't know what the metadata, you don't get access to your senior students or a professor fast enough, and so on. So I mentioned that another big service and part of the acceleration was, instead of actually just getting some flat files, we basically at this point are providing dashboards, curation capabilities, interfaces to actually visualize the data, annotate the data. You can do free text to actually, in your office, you can sort of think about what you wanted to do. So you access your raw data that get transformed, converted, and so on in real time, and you can basically preview them, annotate them, download them, extract them. One of the very important aspects, there was a discussion about metadata here, and the metadata here, for example, some of these images from the microscopes are very much hidden inside of the microscopes, and so we currently are developing different types of extractors to actually extract automatically all of these metadata, so that basically scientists then can search for them. Very important part where a lot of the AI actually happens is in the backend in the cloud, and there again we wanted to work, I am sort of a distributed systems and networking person, cloud person, so we wanted actually to help on two levels. One is actually to give freedom to the researchers to provide workflows, and that was mentioned here, and so express task dependencies, so that basically then through message systems, these various workflows that are task services that are working over the particular data, various AI tasks, I will show some examples. There actually, that was one really important aspect to provide these task workflows. But second thing is that also provide good scheduling and resource allocation in the cloud, so that then you basically can get sort of fast response time as A, you might do some of the curation if you are still at the microscope or in your office fast. So then some of the resource management as well as the task and workflow processing. And so in that particular task workflow processing, as in other sciences, basically our scheduler schedules the various tasks over the data, which are multimodal, and there's basically extractions of the metadata from different microscope, SEM, TEM, AFM, and so on, as well as combining the lecture together between manually entered tagged metadata and the automatically extracted data. Classification, of course, is part of that, as many, many images have been put together. Also, in the semiconductor science, basically, they actually have to correlate between the individual instruments, the data together, and analysis, of course, and predictions are very much part of that overall workflow. And we actually allow researchers, the scientists, to specify these particular graphs, task graphs. They are dependent, and we basically then take them and then run them through the particular resource management, index them appropriately so that then the researchers can query and really have sort of more complex queries. I want to actually comment particularly on the free text, since there is a lot of description what happened, what kind of temperature of the overall clean room was, what was the humidity and so on. Everything then impacts the either the material or the chip development. So we actually use natural language processing also of the free text, filtering, clustering, tagging, many of the AI algorithms. We are users of those to actually provide strong information to the material and semiconductor researchers. One of the things that what we I want to sort of stress with this particular slide is that as we want to accelerate, one of the major problems with acceleration, I'm sure many of you have been experiencing that, is that if people are developing their own custom-based software, it does not scale. Basically, in 4 or 5 years, again, that particular sort of system is obsolete and you have to, again, reprogram it. So one of the things for us is at this point, at least in this particular environment, to really work with cloud software that Google innovates, Amazon innovates, and so on, and we can actually then, these are more than open source, and we actually can then use it. So in this particular case, we use Kubernetes, Apache Zookeeper, RabbitMQ, MongoDB, you name it, and then actually put on top of it the materials, the semiconductor workflow, execution tasks, and the whole resource management. And we anticipate that actually this scales because you know, these researchers are looking at 5, 10, 20, 30 years, right? And rather than sort of disappearing these systems. So I just want to have one or two slides on, I know that we are tight on time. So just to show you a speed up that some of the resource management of many of these AI tasks that are being used on top of the data. You basically, if you don't do very much optimizations on the resources on the cloud, you basically can have a request for particular search and so on. It can go up to 160 seconds to actually get your workflow sort of done and processed, where basically when you start to do much smarter sort of type of resource allocation, understanding what the AI sort of techniques are doing, then for different types of graphs, task graphs, workflow graphs, you can actually really decrease and go speed up the response time to 60 seconds. And then, of course, then in the scientific method loop can actually drive better hypotheses, better sort of insights, and faster insights. The same thing, actually, as systems researchers, we have been looking at speeding up the clouds by, for example, looking at some of these workflow task questions, parallelization, and as these particular tasks are arriving, as well as looking at codependency, where we can use parallelism. So, for example, if you do use parallelism, you can basically get improvement of the response time. So parallel execution and really remove non-blocking, right? Because again, the researchers are waiting. And the accelerating of the science is basically that people don't have to wait when they are submitting searches, when they want to visualize data, and so on. So to conclude, I just want to mention that in terms of accelerating science for this particular domain, material science and sort of the semiconductor, we are starting to bring them hopefully closer by decreasing the lab sessions for both particular domains. As they are producing more data, of course, we do need to do more sort of processing, but it's more on the cloud side. Preserving more data, that's also we feel that it accelerates the science. And then basically getting them much, much faster speed in terms of getting them results, allowing them the flexibility to specify workflows, AI tasks, many of them are. Anyway, so that's basically our, you know, things. We're seeing some really good speed ups and hope to sort of include more of these kind of speed up techniques to accelerate the science.
Respect to research, because I mean, any human endeavor of group of people trying to do processes efficiently, it seems like this is the general structure that would do
right.
that. Which aspect of this is specific to science, do you think?
Well, the science part, I think it's some of these workflows, right? That the scientists have certain processes, right, that they want to execute over that particular data, looking at some of these correlations. And what I am particularly interested that these two different groups are talking about. And I think, as I said, we are in the sort of starting the third year, we are hoping more to understand the correlation in terms of their research, right? I mean, for me, research is do resource allocation, do scheduling, do the writing of the sort of AI classifications and so on. But for me, it's science independent. Maybe the dependency is how they organize their data, right? And what kind of storage systems do we design? The interesting aspect is that particularly in this domain, it seems that they haven't even, because they haven't got the data all together, they haven't even started to think about what astronomers are thinking, what the biologists are thinking, what the medicine is thinking. And I am not quite sure why not, but the feedback we are getting from NIST, the feedback that we are getting from many of these material science laboratories is that it seems like that some of the tools are just not there, organizing all the data and so on. So we are watching over the shoulders for many other sciences to bring it actually into the materials and semiconductor and bring them together.